Ruby makes the same transfer from the city jail to the county jail that he prevented Lee Harvey Oswald from making. Unlike Oswald's transfer, this one takes place without incident.
This is Detective Jim Lavelle. Jim was handcuffed to Oswald when he was shot yesterday. I understand you were also involved in a successful transfer today.
Yes, sir. We transferred Jack Rubin to the county jail this morning. The same officers were beside him this morning that was with Oswald. We moved him without incident. We took him out and put him in a car without any previous publicity and transferred him to the county jail. And at this time, he is in the county jail in a cell.
How did you handle him as you came out of the elevator?
We had him escorted between two officers, had him to stoop over, and when we got him into the back of the squad car, we had him to lay down so that he wouldn't be seen from the rear or the front.
You consider this a good policy to have followed?
In this particular case or the other one?
In this case.
In this case, yes. We think it it works, so if anything, you can't argue with success.
Fine. Thank you very much, sir. Right. This is Bill Lord reporting from the Dallas Police Department.
Deep tragedy is still very much written on the face of this city today. Tonight and today, this city joined the rest of the nation in mourning the president. All schools and businesses were closed. And the most active and the most busy area of the city continued to be this spot on the western edge of the downtown business district. The spot where it began, where it happened. The spot where the assassin waited in the building behind me to fire the fatal bullets into the body of the President of the United States as he passed a few yards to my right. Still the traffic comes, still the people come. They come to stand and quietly look at the spot. A spot now bedecked with floral wreaths from organizations and from individuals of Dallas, some expressing only sympathy, some expressing sympathy and shame. There was sadness in Dallas today, as in the rest of the world, but sadness here compounded with yet another funeral, the funeral of Patrolman J.D. Tippett, the young policeman shot down soon after the president on Friday. And shortly after that, the funeral of Lee Harvey Oswald, the quiet and lonely funeral of Harvey Oswald, the man accused of killing both men. In this building in front of me, the Dallas County Courthouse on the sixth floor in a jail cell, 52-year-old Jack Ruby awaits his fate. He is the man accused of killing Harvey Oswald, as Oswald was about to be transferred to this very same location. Tomorrow, Jack Ruby will go before a grand jury here in Dallas. Most likely, he will be formally indicted, on first-degree murder charges. Tonight, he remains under heavy guard as the people quietly go by. Undoubtedly, there will be more facts, more investigations before everything is known, and perhaps the complete story, will never be written. For now, Dallas simply tries to forget at least some of the cruelty, some of the misfortune that happened here.
For the Navy and the Air Force, the government of Australia, by purchasing $125 million of TFX planes before they are even off the drawing board, has already testified to the merit of this plane, and at the same time, it's confident in the ability of Fort Worth to meet its schedule. In all these ways, the success of our national defense depends upon this city in the western United States, 10,000 miles from Vietnam, 5,000 or 6,000 miles from Berlin, thousands of miles from trouble spots in Latin America and Africa or the Middle East. And yet Fort Worth and what it does and what it produces participates in all these great historic events. Texas as a whole and Fort Worth bear particular responsibility for this national defense effort. For military procurement in this state totals nearly $1.25 billion, fifth highest among all the states of the Union. There are more military personnel on active duty in this state than any in the nation save one. and it's not Massachusetts. Any in the nation, say one, where they... with a combined military-civilian defense payroll of well over $1 billion. I don't recite these for any partisan purpose. They're the result of American determination to be second to none. And as a result of the effort which this country has made in the last 3 years, we are second to none. In the past 3 years, we have increased the defense budget of the United States by over 20%, increased the program of acquisition for Polaris submarines from 24 to 41, increased our Minuteman missile purchase program by more than 75%, doubled the number of strategic bombers and missiles on alert, doubled the number of nuclear weapons available in the strategic alert forces, increased the tactical nuclear forces deployed in Western Europe by over 60%. Added 5 combat-ready divisions to the armies of the United States and 5 tactical fighter wings to the Air Force of the United States. Increased our strategic airlift capability by 75% and increased our special counterinsurgency forces, which are engaged now in South Vietnam, by 600%. I hope those who want a strong America and place it on some signs will also place those figures next to it. This is not an easy effort. This requires sacrifice by the people of the United States. But this is a very dangerous and uncertain world. As I said earlier, on 3 occasions in the last 3 years, the United States has had a direct confrontation. No one can say when it will come again. No one expects our life will be easy, certainly not in this decade, and perhaps not in this century. But we should realize what a burden and responsibility the people of the United States have borne for so many years. Here, a country which lived in isolation, divided and protected by the Atlantic and the Pacific, uninterested in the struggles of the world around it, here, in the short space of 18 years after the Second World War, we put ourselves, by our own will and by necessity, into defensive alliances with countries all around the globe. Without the United States, South Vietnam would collapse overnight. Without the United States, the CETO alliance would collapse overnight. Without the United States, the CENTO alliance would collapse overnight. Without the United States, there would be no NATO. And gradually Europe would drift into neutralism and indifference. Without the effort of the United States and the Alliance for Progress, the communist advance onto the mainland of South America would long ago have taken place. So this country, which desires only to be free, which desires to be secure, which desires to live at peace for 18 years under 3 different administrations, has borne more than its share of the burden, has stood watch for more than its number of years. I don't think that we are fatigued or tired. We would like to live as we once lived, but history will not permit it. The communist balance of power is still strong. The balance of power is still on the side of freedom. We are still the keystone and the arch of freedom, and I think we will continue to do as we have done in our past, our duty, and the people of Texas will be in the lead. So I'm glad to come. I'm glad to come to this state, which has played such a significant role in so many efforts in this century, and to say that here in Fort Worth, you people will be playing a major role in the maintenance of the security of the United States for the next 10 years. I'm confident, as I look to the future, that our chances for security, our chances for peace, are better than they've been in the past. And the reason is because we're stronger. And with that strength is a determination to not only maintain the peace, but also the vital interests of the United States. To that great cause, Texas and the United States are committed. Thank you.
The sun began breaking through the clouds as the presidential motorcade left the Hotel Texas en route to Carswell Air Force Base. Once again, crowds lined the streets to catch a glimpse of the Kennedys. And at Carswell, the president and Mrs. Kennedy took time out to shake hands and sign autographs before boarding Air Force One for a quick 8-minute trip to Dallas. There, they were to attend a luncheon at the Trademark. At Love Field, it was the same scene once again. The president would disembark and head straight for the crowds. Channel 8's news director, Bob Walker, described the event for the broadcast pool.
As Mrs. Kennedy and the crowd yells, and the President of the United States. And I can see his suntan all the way from here. Shaking hands now with the Dallas people, Governor and Mrs. Connally. Governor Connally on your left. Mr. Eric Johnson in the official welcoming party. Mr. Connally shaking hands with Dr. Berkner. The president now partially obscured behind his wife and a big bouquet of flowers. Working their way slowly, Judge Barefoot Sanders meeting the president, who gave him a pat on the shoulder. Judge Lou Sterrett now just visible. Governor Connally with his arm around the president. Kennedy backs up and waits for the president, who stopped to chat with some of the people greeting him here. Crowd waving, as you can see. People standing up all over everything available to get a glimpse of the president and his wife. Cheering and yelling going on down the way as they approach the cars. Beautiful break in the weather. Just a beautiful break in the weather. Clear blue sky and a warm sun. Nixon has gone home for the benefit of that person with the sign. He left at 9:05 this morning. The vice president, former vice president, was in town yesterday. Crowd forming around the president and first lady. That's the official party, not the general public, who is not allowed out. Beyond the restraining fence here at Love Field. Now they are heading over to the car. Partially obscured from our sight at the moment. People breaking away now, running over to get behind other fences to catch a better glimpse of the caravan, as it would leave, will leave here shortly and go to downtown Dallas. The president is up to the fence now, shaking hands with people. The president and his wife are right up on the fence. The press is standing up high, getting a lot of shots of this. He's done as he has done in several places. He's broken away from his planned plan and gone right up to the fence to shake hands with people. This is great for the people and makes the eggshells even thinner for the Secret Service, whose job it is to guard the man. But the audience loves this. Mrs. Kennedy's beautiful pillbox hat was the only thing that gave it away. I saw the hat, and I knew they were there. And, of course, the press going high and shooting right down below as the president and his wife kind of moving along the gate. People yelling at them, people running on the inside now, trying to come down to this end of the gate, this end of the fenced-off area, hoping that the president and his wife will move along the fence. People out with cameras, just holding him up and snapping away and hoping to get a picture out of their very own camera of the president and his wife. president still walking along that inside fence, shaking hands, talking with people who have come out to greet him. They didn't expect this. Now, as he becomes more visible down to this end, the people cheer. And here they come, right down toward us. I can see Mrs. Kennedy. And they're going to come right on down and shake hands with everybody. Mrs. Kennedy gave a lovely smile and a wave at that time. Mrs. Kennedy, right up. There's the president shaking hands with the people. He's waving at a lot of people, smiling. Secret Service men all around. Boy, this is something. They break right away and come right up to the fence. And the people who waited all morning in this fence are rewarded with a glimpse, and a lot of them with a close look and a handshake with the President of the United States and his wife. And he's coming right down to toward us and toward our fine camera positions here. The press is having a field day. Somebody perched up on somebody's shoulders. President saying, thank you very much. If I may be permitted to read a presidential lip movement. This is a bonus for the people who have waited out here. Now, Mrs. Kennedy, right along behind him, president still moving over towards some phone booths that were set up for the press, the people surging up toward that fence, but there is a fence, and the president waves goodbye, waits for his wife, and back they go to the car. Governor Connally standing in the car, beaming. Governor Connally with a big 10-gallon hat on. Kennedy stepping in the car first. Now the president, they both in the back seat now. Now the motorcade will very shortly start to move out. Sheriff Bill Decker, Dallas County Sheriff, driving his own car, personally escorting it with the chief of police, the presidential car moving out. The president and first lady. Big, beautiful Lincoln, followed by a carload of press. Secret Service men, the car behind. Then comes the Vice President and Mrs. Johnson, Senator Yarborough. Now people over in this area are getting a chance to see the president. That motorcade will swing way around, go by the Continental Airlines maintenance hangar, head out for downtown Dallas, where thousands should already be on the street right now, waiting for a view of the president and his wife. Dallas police out here in force today, doing a beautiful job of handling the crowd, along with a contingent of Texas Rangers. And I still can't get over the fact that the president and his wife broke away from the planned trek to the automobiles and went all along this fence out here, right up to the fence, shaking hands and talking with these hundreds of people gathered inside that fenced-off area. It was a great thrill to them and a complete surprise. So the party now is leaving Dallas Love Field. The three big White House press charter buses behind us getting ready to pull out. And, of course, as we say, thousands will be on hand for that motorcade now, which will be downtown Dallas, down Cedar Springs, to Harwood, and on Harwood it'll turn on Main, from which point it'll go all the way down to the courthouse area, which is the end of Main. It'll turn on Houston Street to Elm under the Triple Underpass, out to the Mart where the president talks at approximately 1 o'clock, which will also be carried live right here on most of these channels. And then we'll be back here again, of course, as we told you, at about 2:15 for the president's departure.
The president had about 10 minutes to live. Crowds lined the streets in downtown Dallas as the motorcade proceeded past City Hall, down Main Street, cutting across Houston, and then down Elm Street and past the Schoolbook Depository building. Then there were gunshots and pandemonium broke loose.
Well, we had proceeded west on Elm Street at approximately 15 to 20 miles an hour. When we heard the first shot, I thought it was a motorcycle backfiring. And I looked back over to my left, and also President Kennedy looked back over his left shoulder. Then when the second shot came, I looked back just in time to see the president struck in the face by the second bullet. Slumped forward into Ms. Kennedy's lap, and when it was apparent to me that we were being fired upon, I went ahead of the president's car to inform Chief Curry that the president had been hit, and then he instructed us over there to take him to Parkland Hospital, and he had Parkland Hospital stand by. And I went on up ahead of notify the officers that were leading the escort that he had been hit. We're going to have to move out.
You did not see the person who fired the shot?
No, sir. It was back over my right shoulder.
The president and Mrs. Kennedy were in the back seat. They had a little dog between them looking at it. And just as the car came right in line with us, the president looked up. And just as he looked up, two shots rang out. And he grabbed his chest, and this real odd look came over his face, and he pitched forward onto her lap. And she jumped up over him at that and screamed and said, "My God, he's been shot." And there was just an instantaneous, sort of an instant pause, and in the motorcade it momentarily halted. And three or four more shots rang out, and they sped away real quickly. And by that time, I became aware of Mary tugging on my foot, saying, "Get down, they're shooting." And it hadn't registered. I'd been so busy looking at the president.
You were in a very advantageous spot to see the president.
To see the president, but also to get shot.
Slumped. Jackie Kennedy was leaning towards him to see. I guess it all happened so suddenly, I don't think anyone realized, you know, what had happened.
Did you realize what had happened when you heard the shots?
No, I didn't. There was, three or four real close together, and it was... must have been the first one that shot him, because that's when that was the time I took the picture. And during that time, after I took the picture, and the shots were still being fired, I decided I'd better get on the ground.
Did people lie down on the ground?
I just know about myself and the ones right close to me. And, well, really, I just know about myself.
You did lie down?
I did. I was no more than 15 foot from the car and in line of fire, evidently.
Did Mrs. Kennedy scream on the first shot?
I don't know about the first shot, but she did scream. She says, "My God, he's been hit," or "he's been shot."
And the president fell in Mrs. Kennedy's arms?
No, I think he just slumped into the seat. She jumped up over him, and... during time when she jumped up, of course, the car sped away real fast.
The president's car was some 50 feet still yet.
In front of you?
In front of us, coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the president, I don't know who was hit first, but the president jumped up in his seat, and I thought it scared him. I thought it was a firecracker, because he looked, you know, fear. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the president in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall. I don't know what you call it.
For the benefit of nomenclature, all of you folks have gone out under the viaduct, and as you turn going under the viaduct on the left-hand side, there's some grass. Do you think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president? Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, the little mound of ground there, the garden.
How far away would you say that is from where the president was? A couple of 300 yards, something like that?
Well, I have no idea, because I didn't see where the gunshot come from. We were looking directly at the president when he was hit, and he was more or less directly in front of us, and we didn't realize what happened until we seen the side of his head whenever the bullet hit him in the head.
Did you see the blood coming from the president's head?
Yes, sir, we seen that. I seen that. I don't know if my wife did, but I seen that.
Were you in the line of fire? I noticed, I remember vividly whenever I walked over and looked over the banister there and saw across the street that you were down on the ground so that to keep out of the line of fire. What was the first thought that struck your mind?
I thought it was a firecracker, and I saw the blood, and I had the baby, and I just ran, and I got on top of him and laid on the grass. It just scared me. It was terrible.
Did you see anyone else hit besides the...
Governor Conley was kind of turned to the side, and he grabbed his stomach.
Do you have any idea which direction the shots came from that hit the president or Conley? Did you say that one of the shots came from one direction and one from another, it seemed like?
No, sir. Actually, I feel that they both come from directly behind where we were standing.
Right behind you.
The president, it looked like he was looking in that direction. I don't know whether he was hit first. Apparently, he wasn't. It looked like he jumped up in his seat, and when he jumped up, well, he was shot directly in the head. And I don't know what you call it, the mall behind us, but apparently that's
where he was. I know that a few minutes after that, when I came over there and asked you people if you'd be kind enough to come over and be on our station today, I know that the police were all taking off up the ramp and over.
Everybody was going in that direction.
Toward
yes,
the
sir.
Railroad.
Yes, sir.
Cars, back over in there.
I just hope the man that shot the president, I just hope they don't kill him. I hope he lives. I hope he just lives to regret what he did.
Yeah, can I have your name?
J.H. Sawyer.
And your position?
Inspector, please.
What is the story here now? This is apparently the building that the assassin shot from.
This is the building that the witnesses said they had seen a man up there and some with a rifle. And also we found some empty rifle shells on the fifth floor.
So he would have been directly above us?
Directly above us. Indications were that he had been there for some time.
Well, has the police department taken any precautions against such an incident?
We thought we had taken all of the precautions that were necessary. But this particular building was not covered, as were a lot of other buildings.
So as it stands now, there is a suspect. There were witnesses.
There are witnesses who saw the man.
What did they see as far as the president and the governor?
Well, several of the witnesses saw him slump over.
The president?
Yes.
And the governor?
And the governor, yes.
You also understand a Secret Service man was injured?
This I do not know. I haven't received that information.
This is WFAA-TV in Dallas, Texas. May I have your name, please, sir?
My name is Abraham Zapruder.
Mr. Zapruder?
Zapruder, yes, sir.
Zapruder. And would you tell us your story, please, sir?
I got out and about a half hour earlier and get into a good spot to shoot some pictures. And I found a spot, one of these concrete blocks that I have down near that park near the underpass. And I got on top there. There was another girl from my office. She was right behind me. And as I was shooting, as the president was coming down from Houston Street making his turn, it was about halfway down there, I had a shot. And he slumped to the side like this. Then I had another shot or two. I couldn't say whether it was one or two. And I saw his head practically open up, all blood and everything. And I kept on shooting. That's about all. I'm just sick.
The presidential limousine sped to Parkland Hospital. There, doctors worked in vain to save the life of John Kennedy. He is pronounced dead an hour later. A hearse transports the president's body to Love Field. On board Air Force One, Lyndon Johnson is sworn in as the 36th president of the United States. Then the presidential jet takes off for Washington. It is dark at Andrews Air Force Base when the plane bearing the slain president's body arrives in the nation's capital.
The van that you see, we are assuming, is the vehicle in which the president's body, this is the undoubtedly the casket that is being brought forth. And from the vantage point that he has down there, ABC's Dick Bate will continue the commentary.
Now, accompanied by Secret Service men, it is on a truck, the body of which rises up in the air on a hydraulic lift. This truck has been lifted up to the side of the plane, the back door of the plane, The bronze casket has been pulled off the plane and is now on the bed of the truck. And the body of President Kennedy is back in Washington. On board this same plane, we're told, is President Johnson. Mrs. Kennedy is supposed to be on the plane as well. The body of the truck has now been lowered down to ground level on hydraulic lift. The bronze casket aboard it. A Navy ambulance is pulling up. The bronze casket carrying President Kennedy's body will be taken from here to Bethesda Naval Hospital. Told that sometime tomorrow, President Kennedy's body will be taken to the White House for private ceremonies for the family. Then the plan calls for President Kennedy's body to be taken to the Capitol Rotunda, for public viewing sometime Sunday. Secret Service escort now lifting the bronze casket off the truck, bringing it down onto the field of Andrews Air Force Base. A Navy honor guard alongside. The casket is now being put into a gray Navy ambulance. Mrs. Kennedy is now coming down following the casket. With her, other members of the Kennedy family, the Attorney General can be seen. Mrs. Jacqueline Kennedy, Attorney General Robert Kennedy, have accompanied the casket back here to Washington, are now getting in the ambulance. We'll go with the body to Bethesda Naval Hospital. Giant aircraft that President Kennedy used on all of his trips around the world. And now with the sorrowing Mrs. Kennedy accompanying the body of her husband, Navy ambulance pulls away from the airfield here and heads toward the Bethesda Naval Hospital. Johnson, who's supposed to be on this same plane. The word here from the Pentagon is that President Johnson will have a statement to make here at the airport. Officials at the Department of Defense were in touch with the aircraft by radio as it made its way back to Washington from Texas. Now the steps have been rolled up to the same back door of the jet airliner. President Johnson is expected to come down in just a moment. Coming down the steps now, down on the ground. Mrs. Johnson with him. President Johnson coming over to the microphone, accompanied by military aides, Secret Service men. Security precautions here at the airport have been redoubled tonight. President Johnson has called a special meeting of congressional leaders. We're told there's a possibility of a cabinet meeting at the White House tonight. Many members of cabinet here at the airport. Members of the diplomatic colony in Washington, and a crowd of average citizens who turned out to pay their respects to President Kennedy's return to Washington. The ambulance carrying the casket has gone on into the city, and President Johnson is now before the microphones for his first public statement as President of the United States. President Johnson is beside him, the first lady now. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we take you to the microphones, and in the background of the noise here, they're still standing, the pictures are being taken. He is not ready to speak at the moment. We will watch and see just as soon as he is ready to speak. Another word is being given to him at the present time, and Lyndon Johnson is still standing there. They're looking at the plane, the people gathered around, the officials. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
It is a sad time for all people. We have suffered a loss that cannot be waived. For me, it is a deep personal tragedy. I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear. I will do my best. That is all I can do. I ask for your help and God.
In Dallas, police converged on the Texas Theater in Oak Cliff. A policeman had been shot and witnesses had reported the suspect entering the theater. There, officers apprehended Lee Harvey Oswald.
Well, I walked into the rear exit after a person had pointed out a person had run into the theater in a suspicious way. And there was about 15 people inside the theater at the time. And there's one person sitting back there alone near the rear of the theater. And as I approached him about 1 foot from him, he jumped out of his seat and held his hands up and says, "This is it." And he hit me in the face with his fist, blooding my nose, and I immediately grabbed him. And he went for his gun that was in his waist. And I went at the same time, and we were struggling in there, and I received a scratch on my cheek, evidently from the hammer of the gun as it came out of his belt. And as it was coming out, he snapped the trigger on the pistol, which misfired, luckily.
Was the pistol loaded?
Yes, fully loaded. It had 6 rounds in it.
Had you ever had an experience like this before?
Well, not this desperate, no, sir.
What was his mental state at the time of capture? Was he hysterical or screaming or...
Well, he was cool and calm up until the time that he made that jump for me. And the whole time I watched him, as I approached him, he was calm. He didn't move, he didn't flinch.
Just as I got to the back of the theater, I noticed the scuffling that was going on between Patrolman McDonald and this suspect. I immediately, in some way, I don't know how, I sprained my ankle in getting over the seats to aid Patrolman McDonald, but in aiding him, I twisted my ankle, causing some severe strain to my ankle. At the time I got a hold of the suspect, Patrolman McDonald was scuffling with him, trying to get the gun away from him. And by the time we got him pretty well subdued, we had the assistance of 4 or 5 other patrolmen and other officers.
I believe the crutches behind me are evidence of the injuries you suffered in yesterday's capture. What would be your description of the suspect at the time?
At the time I encountered the suspect, of course, he was resisting and fighting and scuffling with Patrolman McDonald, and of course, scuffling with the rest of us. He was subdued and handcuffed and was making several remarks as we removed him from the theater out to the squad waiting to transport him down to Homicide and Robbery Bureau. I accompanied the officers to Homicide and Robbery Bureau in the squad and talked with the suspect on the way to the city hall. His comment was, "Why are you placing me in jail when all I have done is carried a pistol into a theater?" We explained to him that he was being placed in jail for suspicion of murder regarding the patrolman J.D. Tippett. He stated he had not shot anyone at that time and became very belligerent on the way to the city hall. We advised him that he could do his talking a little bit later. He was then taken and turned over to Captain Fritz.
You made no mention to him of the possible charges of murdering the president at that time?
No, sir, I did not myself, because at the time of the arrest, I had no knowledge whatsoever that this might possibly be our suspect in regards to the assassination of the president.
Someone saw him going to Texas Theater. A search was made of that later by a number of police officers. At the time, an officer of the Dallas police hunted him and asked him to come out. He struck at the officer, put the gun against his head, and snapped it, but did not, the bullet did not go off. We have the snapped bullet there. Officers subdued him at that time.
Was that an attempt suicide, sir?
Against the officer's head.
You know why the gun didn't
McDonald was his name. It snapped. It was a misfire. Officers subdued him. Some six officers subdued him there in the theater, and he was brought to the police station here. His fingerprints were found on the gun. On the rifle.
What about the paraffin test?
Yes, I haven't gone into that. The paraffin test showed that he had recently fired a gun. It was on both hands.
Both hands. A gun.
The rifle fingerprints were his, the rifle? Yes.
Were there any fingerprints?
Palm print rather than fingerprint.
Were there any fingerprints at the window?
On the sixth floor of the school book depository, police found a high-powered rifle equipped with a scope, and they linked it to Lee Harvey Oswald. Oswald was an ex-Marine who had defected to Russia. He was a self-proclaimed Marxist who had worked for the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. Oswald spent the rest of Friday and all day Saturday answering questions posed by Dallas Homicide Chief Captain Will Fritz. And although charged with murdering the President of the United States, Oswald denied everything.
Here comes Oswald down the hall again.
You buy that rifle?
I don't know what dispatches you people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges.
Oswald has hustled through a doorway. He says he has nothing against anybody. He has not committed any act of violence. Oswald makes this claim as he's hustled from the interrogation room through a doorway down an elevator. Up an elevator into his jail cell. His face is very badly discolored, the results of a scuffle with police when he was apprehended the other day. Now, Oswald has made his latest flat denials in the face of a mounting pile of evidence against him. The last links in this case seem to be hammered into place tonight. Police have traced a rifle purchased in Chicago by mail order for $12.78. They've traced it to Oswald. He bought it under the alias of A. Heidel. Handwriting experts have established that the handwriting on the purchase order was, in fact, made by Oswald. At the price of $12.78, the life of the President of the United States apparently was bought.
How long has he been under questioning now?
I don't know exactly how long he's been under question. It's been intermittent. It has not been continuous.
But so far, he's given absolutely no sign of weakening under the questioning?
No.
Are you and the rest of the police convinced you have the right man now?
I think we do.
Are there any other suspects linked with Oswald?
No. Not prime suspects there. There's others we want to talk to.
On Sunday morning, November 24th, 1963, police made preparations to transfer Oswald from the city jail to the county jail at the other end of town.
Behind me is the building from which the shots were fired that killed the President of the United States. This building, located at Elm and Houston Streets, is actually only a half block away from the county courthouse. This is where Lee Harvey Oswald is going to be transferred from the city jail in the downtown municipal building to this, the county jail. How do you feel about this incident?
I'm sure I still don't realize it or couldn't believe it. I'm from Duluth, Minnesota.
Were you here in Dallas to see the president?
Yes. We had just arrived a couple days ago.
And you boys, what are you here for now?
We were just standing here to see when the man would come.
But then things took a bizarre twist in the basement of Dallas City Hall.
Bob Walker, WFAA-TV, Dallas, Texas, interrupting. There's been a shooting at Dallas Police Station as Oswald was being transferred. For details, Bill Lord, ABC at City Hall. Bill.
Just 1 minute ago, they were bringing Oswald out. He had apparently changed clothes. He was just going out the door, heading towards the armored car, and there was a bang. We believe it was a shot. And apparently, what has happened to it, we do not know at the present time. A policeman rushed to the scene, attempting to ascertain what had happened. The photographers were taking pictures. Is there someone down on the floor over there? Is there someone injured down on the floor?
Apparently,
Oswald is the word we get, but this is unconfirmed because no one can really see what has happened. There was a shot, one shot, and everyone here jumped to see what had happened. Apparently, Oswald was shot by a small, elderly man. An elderly man with a small revolver. Where I'm standing...
How far are you away, Bill?
I'm about 20 feet away from apparently where Oswald is. If this is Oswald, down on the floor, I cannot see him. There's a bench in between me. But they are examining a man who was on the floor, and the police look very concerned at this moment. The report is that an elderly man with a small revolver. Again, I caution that this I did not see, but these are the reports. There is someone down on the floor. A detective put his hand up on his forehead, shaking it. Oh, no, this has happened. There are two men down, apparently, but only one shot was fired. Can we get confirmation? Is that Oswald? They saw Oswald lying on the floor. He is injured. They're taking him back upstairs now. His shirt is ripped open.
Can you tell where he was shot, Bill?
No, we cannot tell that. No, we're not sure if that was Oswald. They believe that might have been the man who did the shooting. His shirt is ripped apart. Oswald is on the floor.
Is he alive, Doctor?
No.
Let Dr. Shires make his statement, please.
When did he die, Doctor?
He died at 1:07 our time, 13:07, of his gunshot wound. Would you like to ask questions or what? Yeah, Mr. Oswald died at 1:07 our time in the operating room of the gunshot wound which he had received.
Would you describe his last moments on the operating table, please?
The last moments were rather hectic. He had a cardiac arrest from all the massive blood loss, the massive injury. The last few minutes were spent in cardiac resuscitation, open heart massage, electrical defibrillation, internal defibrillation, and finally there were absolutely no signs of life at all, fixed dilated pupils and all the signs of death.
And now let's talk to some of the people who have come here today. What do you think about the shooting today of the suspected assassin, Lee Oswald?
I think it is extremely regrettable. I believe the dignity of our country would have been preserved if he had had the right of trial by jury, which is what President Kennedy stood for.
You seem very emotionally involved in this, are you?
I'm not used to speaking into a mic or any of this sort of thing, and I think we've all been emotionally involved.
There have been some people parading about town with signs that read, Long Live Jack Ruby. What do you think about that?
I think that should be left up to a jury to decide whether he should live or whether he should die.
I believe the same he does. That's what the laws are for.
Well, a consensus of opinion in this crowd at least, that the slaying of President Kennedy should have been dealt with by a jury in the American tradition. But by all odds, the people who come here today aren't overly concerned with today's killing. They are concerned with the death of a president widely beloved. Paul Good, ABC, Dallas.
Oswald's assailant was identified as Jack Ruby, a Dallas nightclub owner. He said he killed Oswald so Mrs. Kennedy would not have to suffer. On Monday morning, the entire nation would watch as the 35th President of the United States was eulogized. His body, borne by caissons, made its way down Pennsylvania Avenue from the Capitol, past the White House, and on to Arlington National Cemetery for the burial. After Monday, it was a time to find answers. A reenactment of the presidential motorcade took place. Ballistics experts came in to figure out just how the assassination took place. Was there more than one gunman? And where had the gunman or gunmen actually been when the shots were fired? Investigators began trying to find out if there was a connection between Lee Harvey Oswald and Jack Ruby, and to determine if the two had been part of a conspiracy. Tuesday, November 26, 1963. Life must go on for America and her people. The past 4 days have seen the President of the United States gunned down, a new president sworn in. The president's accused assassin has himself been shot to death, and the nation has paid its respects to its fallen leader. Dallas Police Chief Jesse Curry announces that he plans to release all the material in the Oswald case when it is completed. And before the week is over, Jack Ruby will be indicted by the Dallas County Grand Jury. And the people of Dallas will begin asking themselves why it all had to happen here.
Ruby made no appearance in court today as he was indicted for murder with malice, a charge that could bring his execution. D.A. Henry Wade explained.
The Dallas County Grand Jury met this morning at 8:30, heard evidence against Jack Rubenstein, alias Jack Ruby, for the murder of Lee Oswald. He was indicted. The indictment's returned to Judge Joe B. Brown's court. It's been set down for a hearing on December the 9th. This is a most aggravated killing. It's an assassination. The case in which we will ask the death penalty and think that's the only proper punishment.
Ruby's defense plans were told to ABC's Bill Lord by attorney Tom Howard.
In my opinion, based on the evidence as I know it now, Jack Ruby should go free based on his mental condition as it was at the time I talked to him shortly after the shooting.
Does this indicate that you will enter a plea of temporary insanity?
Well, I don't want to say yes or no, but certainly that's under consideration.
For the city of Dallas, a return to near normal today. Mayor Earl Cabell, before a packed council chamber, called for civic unity.
First views. But I call upon all of our citizens to enter into controversy without hatred, disagreement without disparagement. And I ask that we allow ourselves to be intolerant only with intolerance whenever we find it in our midst. I am convinced that the grievous events we have just endured can teach us the most profound lesson of all, that our best laid plans are not good enough without the benefit of a wisdom greater than our own.
A city saddened but still proud. Roger Sharp, ABC, Dallas.
Jack Ruby will later stand trial in Dallas, where he will be convicted of Oswald's murder and assess the death penalty.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have reached a verdict in this case. May I have it, Sheriff, please?
There is the verdict, O'Mabra handing it to the judge.
We, the jury, find the defendant guilty of murder with malice as charged in the indictment and assess his punishment at death. Signed, Max E. Causey, Foreman. So say you all, ladies and gentlemen. Is that your unanimous verdict? Will all of you whose verdict that is, please hold up your right hands. All right, Sheriff, he's your prisoner.
But the court will be reversed, and a new trial set for Wichita Falls. Ruby will die of cancer before ever standing trial again. And the world will never know if he was part of some conspiracy.
The world will never know the true facts of what occurred, my motives. In other words, I'm the only person in the background that knows the truth pertaining to everything relating to my circumstances.
Do you think it'll ever come out?
No, because unfortunately, the people had so much to gain and had such an ulterior motive for putting me in a position I'm in. We'll never let the true facts to the world.
For the city of Dallas, there are questions concerning the police department and its handling of the past 4 days. City Councilman Joe Moody addresses that subject.
Now, the questions the people of Dallas would like to have answered, and I speak, I believe, for the majority of the citizens of Dallas, are the following regarding the death of Mr. Oswald. Number one, were our officers and detectives given instructions to restrict City Hall to entrance to authorized personnel only? If so, who gave those instructions? What specifically were those instructions? Were they violated? Who violated them? Why? What disciplinary action is to be taken? The whole world is watching us. They will judge us if we do not judge ourselves. And I don't feel like that the Attorney General or the Justice Department ought to come down here and take disciplinary action against our police department. I believe that if these words that we say are so fine, let's clean up our own house and let's do it within a matter of a few hours as we have done previously.
This is City Manager Elgin Krull. Mr. Krull, did you speak to the police chief this morning?
I talked to the chief of police and some of his senior officers this morning.
The rumor has been spread that he might resign.
I don't know where these rumors originate. They're completely unfounded. The chief has not offered to resign. He has not been asked to resign. And if he offered to resign, the offer would be declined. He is the chief of the department, and we expect him to continue to be the chief of the department.
How would you evaluate Mr. Curry as the chief of police?
He's one of the outstanding chiefs of police in the United States. And despite all the difficulties of the last few days, it hasn't changed his standing or his ability.
Yesterday's incident, would you say all necessary security precautions had been taken?
Obviously, I haven't any grounds to comment specifically on this. Obviously, some precaution wasn't taken because the man got in. Whether or not it's something that could have been foreseen, I'm not in a position to say.
Do you expect to receive any resignations from any members of the police department?
I don't expect to receive any resignations from the department. I expect the department to go ahead and do its job. It's one of the finest departments in the country. There have been some awful bad breaks, and they're hard on the men in the department, but it hasn't changed my estimate of the department, the quality of the men in it, in any way whatsoever.
Thank you very much, sir. The city manager of Dallas. This is Bill Lord reporting from the Dallas Police Headquarters.
The city of Dallas is also faced with the question of whether to erect a memorial for the slain president. There are several suggestions. Opinions vary. Dallas Mayor Earl Cabell says the memorial should be placed in the nation's capital.
Very frankly, I think that the memorial to the President of the United States should belong to all of the people of the United States, and that such a monument as befits the late great President should be erected in our national capital, where it is, where that automatically makes such a monument the property of all the people. It shall be my suggestion to the Park Board tomorrow that Dallas take the initiative, the people of Dallas take the initiative in starting a national citizens' fund for the erection of a monument in our nation's capital. And in that way, we will initiate the movement and then let that be then our contribution to the nation and to the people of the nation to start this fund for the erection of the monument in our national capital, where others of our great heroes are also properly enshrined and memorialized.
Texas Governor John Connally, who was also hit by the gunfire that struck down the president, is still in Parkland Hospital. For the first time, he talks about what happened to him in that motorcade.
I am in Parkland Memorial Hospital in Dallas at the bedside of Governor John Connally, where he is recovering from his wounds. Governor Connally, what are your recollections of those terrible moments when you and President Kennedy were shot?
Martin, just before it occurred, of course, we'd had a great morning in Fort Worth, a magnificent breakfast. He spoke in a slight drizzle. We made the trip to Dallas with huge throngs along the way. We got into downtown Dallas. There were tremendous crowds, real warmth, real understanding, real appreciation. And Nellie and I saw it so vividly because we were riding in the car with them. We did not attempt to acknowledge the obvious ovation that they were getting because we knew it was for the Kennedys. The reception had been magnificent. The president had remarked on it, and so had Miss Kennedy. As a matter of fact, I guess not 30 seconds before the tragic incident occurred, that Nellie had turned to the president and said, "Mr. President, they can't make you believe now that there are not some in Dallas who love you and appreciate you, can they?" And he said, "No, they sure can't." And then we had just turned the corner. We heard a shot. I turned to my left. I was sitting in the jump seat. I turned to my left to look in the back seat. The president had slumped. He had said nothing. Almost simultaneously, as I turned, I was hit. And I knew I'd been hit badly. And I said, I knew the president had been hit, and I said, "My God, they're going to kill us all." And then there was a third shot, and the president was hit again. And we thought then very seriously. I had still regained consciousness, but the president had slumped in Ms. Kennedy's lap. And when he was hit the second time, she said, or the first time, it all happened in such a brief span, she said, "Oh, my God, they killed my husband." She said, Jack. And then after the third shot, the next thing that occurred, I was conscious. The Secret Service man, of course, the chauffeur had pulled out of the line. They said, "Get out of here." On the radios, they said, "Get us to a hospital immediately." And so we pulled out, of course, and immediately as fast as we could go and got to the hospital. And in the space of a few seconds, it's unbelievable what can happen. Martin, we went from great joy, anticipation, wonderful crowds, wonderful throngs, to great tragedy.
Governor, what are the thoughts that have come to you as you've lain here in this hospital bed recovering from your wounds?
Oh, Martin, there have been many and many subjects. And I just wonder, you wonder all types of things. You wonder why his life was taken, why my life was spared. And I know, of course, that some now speculate that, well, it was me the man was after, not him. Of course, I have been campaigning all over Texas all last year for 11 months. All this year, riding parades, horseback, in cars, open cars, on street corners,
I could have been an easy prey for anyone with no security whatever. So I don't place any stead in this, except I think the man did what he intended to do, shoot both of us. And that's the only thing I can think.
What other reflections have you had, Governor?
Only that maybe, Martin, that the President of the United States, as a result of this great tragedy, has been asked to do something in death he couldn't do in life. And that is to so shock and so stun a nation and the people and the world of what's happening to us, of the cancerous growth that's being permitted to expand and enlarge itself upon the community and the society in which we live, that breeds a hatred, a bigotry, an intolerance, an indifference, a lawlessness that is, I think, really an outward manifestation of what occurred here in Dallas. It could have occurred in any other city in America. It is nothing more than the manifestation of an extremism on both sides that basically is the genesis of our self-destruction if we're ever going to be destroyed. I am not the least fearful of any foreign enemy, so long as we have within ourselves not hate, but human understanding, not passion and prejudice, but reason and tolerance, and not ignorance, but knowledge, and the willingness to use that knowledge. This is the only answer I can give, Martin, why he's gone and I'm not.
Governor, when did they tell you that President Kennedy was dead?
They told me Saturday, after I was conscious enough really to understand. It was no news, Nellie told me. And it was no news to me, though, because I was almost sure that he would be, after the two shots that I felt he'd taken. I hoped, as everyone else did, of course, and I hoped longer than most, because I did not know until long after most people knew that he had succumbed, because I personally felt that I had been killed, too, when I received my shot.
Yes. What were your first conscious thoughts about the President's death?
Martin, my really first conscious thoughts are still my same conscious thoughts. Just, my God, what a horrible, horrible tragedy. And how, in the space of a fleeting moment, things can change. Only before, here were two relatively young men, we were almost identical age, riding with what I would like to believe two of the most beautiful wives in this country. We'd been together for 24 hours. They were happy. We were their host. We were proud to be their host in Texas. They had a tremendous welcome in San Antonio, in Houston, in Fort Worth, in Dallas. And then in a matter of a few seconds, this incident occurred that changed all our lives, changed the course of history for many people, and in what many divergent ways, you never know. And it makes you reflect, ponder, wonder. If you do all that you ought to do, day by day, in trying to make whatever contribution you can to the society in which you live, because you never know when your day may come.
Governor, many Americans feel that we should have a memorial to the President. Have you thought about that? What kind?
Martin, I would most certainly think we ought to have a memorial to the President. I don't know what kind. It could be any kind. It could be marble. It could be granite. Could be stone, but really, I would hope that if the American people build a monument to President Kennedy, that they not do it in a sense of absolving themselves of the sins, which I think we all must suffer, for a lack of tolerance, a lack of understanding, for the prejudice, the passion, the hate, and the bigotry that permeates this whole society in which we live, that I think manifested itself here on Saturday. I think this was only one facet of it. We see it in the bombings of five little children, five little girls in Birmingham. It happens elsewhere in the United States. We, I think, above all else, if we erect such a monument, we ought to erect it as a monument to patience, to tolerance, to knowledge, to human understanding, to human dignity, freedom of the individual, and society that lives under law and under God, and where each can respect each other, notwithstanding that they disagree with them, because we have permitted the circumstances to occur in this country where fanaticism and extremism has become a fad, a fashionable fad. And this has to be destroyed. The people of reason, the people of logic, the people of intelligence are going to have to emerge. They're the people who are the silent people. They're the people who are not speaking. And their voice is going to have to become the dominant voice of this country.
John Fitzgerald Kennedy himself, Governor, was deeply conscious of exactly what you say and addressed himself to it, to people. Governor, you point out the way the fate intervened to literally change the world in this moment. One way that it has changed the world is it's given the United States for the first time in our history a president from your state of Texas. I know how close you are to...
I thought about that, Martin. I've been very close to the president, as you know. I first went to work for him in 1938. I worked for him again in 1949. We served in the uniform of the Navy, as did President Kennedy. President Johnson and I were actually serving together in the Navy during the war. And I thought, how ironic that in spite of the fact that I'd managed his campaign unsuccessfully for the presidency, that the man who defeated him, President Kennedy, named me Secretary of the Navy, a highly treasured position so far as I was concerned. And then on the very day that the president was assassinated and that I was wounded, the result of that was that Mr. Johnson became the president of the United States. And a rather strange set of circumstances.
Tell us something about Lyndon Baines Johnson, Governor.
Martin, he is a person of many complexities, really. He is a person who will be viewed by some as being perhaps unlettered, and in some ways he is unlettered. But in other ways, he's probably as literate a person as you'll ever see in your life. As literate in terms of the understanding of human nature. He will not be the most well-read person you will ever know. But he will have a human instinct that I think will almost surpass any other person that you'll ever encounter. He is a person of great charm, of great poise. At times, and yet at times, he can be almost brusque and rude. Always determined, always firm, always a man of his convictions. An indomitable and indefatigable worker, working always for perfection. Wouldn't you say that's a pretty good analysis of him, sweetheart? Those are the qualities that I would offhand think of, Martin, that I would point out first. I think, naturally, since he is now the President of the United States, that I should also point out, I think it can be fairly said, that no man ever really assumed the burdens of that office, in many ways better equipped than he. Now, that'll come as a strange statement, I'm sure, to some people in this country. But he's, I guess, 55 now, isn't he? 8 years older now. He's 55. He was born in a rugged country of rugged parents. Saw many hard times. They can be even, I would say, poverty-stricken times. The days of his schooling were arduous. He did it himself. He pulled himself up by his own bootstraps. He's worked with people of many nationalities, of many languages, of many economic views, and many economic levels. I think he understands the heartbeat of this nation, probably as well as any man that's ever been president of the United States. He's been a laborer, and not just to be one, to say he'd been one, but because he had to be one. He's been a school teacher, and he knows what it is to teach school in a country school, teaching a bunch of Latin students at Cotulla, Texas. He headed the NYA, Martin, when he was 26 years old.
National Youth Administration.
You remember under Roosevelt days. And he was the youngest NYA administrator in the country. I think by any standards, is one of the finest jobs in the United States. There he worked again with young people, saw the need for education. He has, again, this concept of the needs of youth and what it means and what contribution you can make to young minds and what those young minds can contribute to the welfare of this nation. He's walked among the great and the near great, as you well know. Yet I don't think it has ever changed him in the least. I think he still has the rough hewn, the rough exterior of the hill country from which he came and which he loves. I think he's in many ways as readable as an open book. Yet again, a very complex person. I think for the sake of this nation, I want to repeat two things that I said about him. The first, he is very firm, he's very determined. And I think in our dealings with foreign nations, I know of no man in my lifetime that I would rather be dealing my hand than him.
Governor, I don't want to tax your strength any further. I just want to thank you for a really memorable...
You were wonderful to come. I hope you understand this is the first moment that I have had to say anything or to express anything. We have nearly expressed our mutual concern to Ms. Kennedy in a handwritten note that our son John took and delivered to her at the funeral ceremonies in Washington on Monday. But I'm grateful to you for your being here, and I'm just thankful I can see you again.
Thank you, Governor, and I'm so glad you're all right. And may I say to you, Mrs. Connolly, that I want you to know how all through the nation, everyone admires the grace and the courage of which you conducted yourself in the terrible moments. Thank you. That's the conclusion of the interview with Governor John Connolly at his bedside in the Parkland Memorial Hospital in Dallas, Texas, where the governor is recovering from the wound suffered in the attack by an assassin on himself and the President of the United States.
The nation has a new president. Lyndon Johnson is the first Southerner since before the Civil War to hold the office. Outside of Washington and Texas, very few people know much about him. They get their first long look at him as he addresses a joint session of Congress, his first prepared address since President Kennedy's assassination.
From the chamber of the House of Representatives in the Capitol building here in Washington, D.C., we present the first address of President Lyndon B. Johnson to a joint session of the Congress. President Johnson is expected to enter the chamber momentarily. Senator Carl Hayden, Democrat of Arizona, the President pro tem of the Senate, is presiding at this joint session with the Speaker of the House of Representatives, John McCormick of Massachusetts. Joining the members of the Congress for this joint session are the various members of the President's Cabinet, the Supreme Court of the United States, the Diplomatic Corps, and the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the United States Armed Forces. The President already has arrived here at the Capitol building, and his entry into the House chamber will be announced shortly by the doorkeeper of the House, William B. Miller. The House chamber, of course, is jammed, as it always is for these joint sessions. The galleries are packed, filled with spectators. Mrs. Johnson is seated in the president, the wife of the new president is seated in the box. And by special invitation with her are four of the most eminent Democrats of the land, Mayors Wagner of New York and Richard Daley of Chicago, former Governor David Lawrence of Pennsylvania, and Governor Carl Sanders of Georgia.
Members of the President's Cabinet.
And now the members of the Cabinet file down the aisle after they have been announced by Mr. Miller, the Chief Doorkeeper of the House. You see Secretary Rusk walking side by side with Adlai Stevenson, our ambassador to the UN. And now the President's brother, the Attorney General, President Kennedy's brother, the Attorney General. And the other members are filing in. Last in line is Secretary Celebrezze of Health, Education, and Welfare, whose department was the last one created. Now we are... The House is silent, awaiting the next announcement.
Mr. Speaker, the President of the United States.
Members of the Congress, I have the high privilege and personal honor of presenting to you our former colleague, the President of the United States. Speaker,
Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, members of the House, members of the Senate, my fellow Americans, all I have, I would have given gladly not to be standing here today. The greatest leader of our time has been struck down by the foulest deed of our time. Today, John Fitzgerald Kennedy lives on in the immortal words and works that he left behind. He lives on in the mind and memories of mankind. He lives on in the hearts of his countrymen. No words are sad enough to express our sense of loss. No words are strong enough to express our determination to continue the forward thrust of America that he began. The dream of conquering the vastness of space, the dream of partnership across the Atlantic and across the Pacific as well, the dream of a Peace Corps in less developed nations, the dream of education for all of our children, the dream of jobs for all who seek them and need them, the dream of care for our elderly, the dream of an all-out attack on mental illness, and above all, the dream of equal rights for all Americans, whatever their race or color. These and other American dreams have been vitalized by his drive and by his dedication. And now the ideas and the ideals which he so nobly represented must and will be translated into effective action. Under John Kennedy's leadership, this nation has demonstrated that it has the courage to seek peace, and it has the fortitude to risk war. We have proved that we are a good and reliable friend to those who seek peace and freedom. We have shown that we can also be a formidable foe to those who reject the path of peace and those who seek to impose upon us or our allies the yoke of tyranny. This nation will keep its commitments from South Vietnam to West Berlin. We will be unceasing in the search for peace, resourceful in our pursuit of areas of agreement, even with those with whom we differ, and generous and loyal to those who join with us in common cause. In this age when there can be no losers in peace and no victors in war, we must recognize the obligation to match national strength with national restraint. We must be prepared at one and the same time for both the confrontation of power and the limitation of power. We must be ready to defend the national interest and to negotiate the common interest. This is the path that we shall continue to pursue. Those who test our courage will find it strong, and those who seek our friendship will find it honorable. We will demonstrate anew that the strong can be just in the use of strength, and the just can be strong in the defense of justice. And let all know, we will extend no special privilege and impose no persecution. We will carry on the fight against poverty and misery and disease and ignorance in other lands and in our own. We will serve all the nation, not one sector, or one sector, or one group, but all Americans. These are the United States, a united people with a united purpose. Our American unity does not depend upon unanimity. We have differences, but now, as in the past, we can derive from those differences strength, not weakness, wisdom, not despair. Both as a people and a government, we can unite upon a program which is wise and just, enlightened, and constructive. For 32 years, Capitol Hill has been my home. I have shared many moments of pride with you, pride in the ability of the Congress of the United States to act, to meet any crisis, to distill from our differences strong programs of national action. An assassin's bullet has thrust upon me the awesome burden of the presidency. I am here today to say I need your help. I cannot bear this burden alone. I need the help of all Americans in all America. This nation has experienced a profound shock. And in this critical moment, it is our duty, yours and mine, as the government of the United States, to do away with uncertainty and doubt and delay, and to show that we are capable of decisive action. That from the brutal loss of our leader, we will derive not weakness, but strength. That we can and will act, and act now. From this chamber of representative government, let all the world know and none misunderstand that I rededicate this government to the unswerving support of the United Nations. To the honorable and determined execution of our commitments to our allies. To the maintenance of military strength second to none. To the defense of the strength and the stability of the dollar. To the expansion of our foreign trade. To the reinforcement of our programs of mutual assistance and cooperation in Asia and Africa. And to our alliance for progress in this hemisphere. On the 20th day of January, in 1961, John F. Kennedy told his countrymen that our national work would not be finished in the first 1,000 days, nor in the life of this administration, nor even perhaps in our lifetime on this planet. But he said, let us begin. Today, in this moment of new resolve, I would say to all my fellow Americans, let us continue. This is our challenge, not to hesitate, not to pause, not to turn about and linger over this evil moment, but to continue on our course so that we may fulfill the destiny that history has set for us. Our most immediate tasks are here on this hill. First, no memorial oration or eulogy could more eloquently honor President Kennedy's memory than the earliest possible passage of the Civil Rights Bill for which he fought so long. Have talked long enough in this country about equal rights. We have talked for 100 years or more. It is time now to write the next chapter and to write it in the books of law. I urge you again, as I did in 1957, and again in 1960, to enact a civil rights law so that we can move forward to eliminate from this nation every trace of discrimination and oppression that is based upon race or color. there could be no greater source of strength to this nation, both at home and abroad. And second, no act of ours could more fittingly continue the work of President Kennedy than the early passage of the tax bill for which he fought all this long year. This is a bill designed to increase our national income and federal revenues and to provide insurance against recession. That bill, if passed without delay, means more security for those now working, more jobs for those now without them, and more incentive for our economy. In short, this is no time for delay. It is a time for action. Strong, forward-looking action on the pending education bills to help bring the light of learning to every home and hamlet in America. Strong, forward-looking action on youth employment opportunities. Strong, forward-looking action on the pending foreign aid bill, making clear that we are not forfeiting our responsibilities to this hemisphere or to the world, nor erasing executive flexibility in the conduct of our foreign affairs. And strong, prompt, and forward-looking action on the remaining appropriation bills. In this new spirit of action, the Congress can expect the full cooperation and support of the executive branch, and in particular, I pledge that the expenditures of your government will be administered with the utmost thrift and frugality. I will insist that the government get a dollar's value for a dollar spent. The government will set an example of prudence and economy. This does not mean that we will not meet our unfilled needs or that we will not honor our commitments. We will do both. As one who has long served in both houses of the Congress, I firmly believe in the independence and the integrity of the legislative branch. And I promise you that I shall always respect this. It is deep in the marrow of my bones. With equal firmness, I believe in the capacity and I believe in the ability of the Congress, despite the divisions of opinions which characterize our nation, to act wisely, to act vigorously, to act speedily when the need arises. The need is here. The need is now. I ask your help. We meet in grief, but let us also meet in renewed dedication and renewed vigor. Let us meet in action, in tolerance, and in mutual understanding. John Kennedy's death commands what his life conveyed, that America must move forward. The time has come for Americans of all races and creeds and political beliefs to understand and to respect one another. So let us put an end to the teaching and the preaching of hate and evil and violence. Let us turn away from the fanatics of the far left and the far right, from the apostles of bitterness and bigotry, from those defiant of law, and those who pour venom into our nation's bloodstream. I profoundly hope that the tragedy and the torment of these terrible days will bind us together in new fellowship, making us one people in our hour of sorrow. So let us here highly resolve that John Fitzgerald Kennedy did not live or die in vain. And on this Thanksgiving Eve, as we gather together to ask the Lord's blessing and give Him our thanks, let us unite in those familiar and cherished words, America, America, God shed His grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
the president is leaving the House chamber, pausing to shake hands with so many of his old colleagues in the House and in the Senate, and the other representatives who are gathered here. He pauses now, seems to be looking up at the box in which Mrs. Johnson and her guests are seated. Now he is proceeding amidst applause out towards the great door through which he entered. You have just heard the President of the United States addressing a joint session of the Congress. This special broadcast came to you from Washington, D.C.
You have been watching the Kennedy Tapes, a collection of videotape material from the Channel 8 archives, coverage of the assassination of President Kennedy and subsequent events of that weekend. Thank you very much for joining us. I'm Tracy Rallett, Channel 8 News.
Television's Automotive Magazine, with your host, John Davis.
Hello, and welcome again to Motor Week 89. We're glad to have you with us. America has just inaugurated its 41st president. It's an important historical event with serious political overtones. So leave it to Craig Singhas to find something to do with cars and all that. He's about to take us on a high road look at limousines of the presidents.
One of the earliest presidential limousines still in existence isn't really an automobile at all. Teddy Roosevelt used this horse-drawn carriage as his first line parade vehicle. But even though old Rough and Ready purchased the first presidential car, a white steamer, he much preferred horse-drawn carriages. On the other hand, T.R.'s successor, William Howard Taft, loved to drive that white steamer on Pennsylvania Avenue. It's reported that in 1909, Taft ran a Packard around a racetrack at a then incredible 56 miles per hour. Warren G. Harding wasn't exactly a great president, but he had great taste in inaugural cars, as this Packard Twin 6 can attest. Of course, in 1929, even a ride in this beautiful Pierce Arrow couldn't cheer up outgoing President Calvin Coolidge. Dearborn, Michigan's Henry Ford Museum houses a number of famous presidential limousines, including Franklin Roosevelt's 1939 Lincoln, known as the Sunshine Special. Curator of Transportation, Randy Mason, told us about FDR's favorite car.
The Sunshine Special started out life as a custom-bodied 1939 V12 Lincoln. The interesting thing about the Sunshine Special is that it is really the first car that was ever designed and built to be a first-line presidential parade limousine. And then in 1942, it underwent a partial rebuild, and armor was added at that point. And then it remained in service through the Truman administration up to 1950. The bubble top, the so-called bubble top, the 1950 Lincoln, was used by the Truman, Eisenhower, and Kennedy administrations. And in fact, it became a bubble top during the Eisenhower administrations. The bubble feature was added in 1954.
Tragically, the most famous of the presidential limousines is the X-100, also known as the Kennedy Continental.
The X-100 is a 1961, or started out life as a 1961 Lincoln. And of course, it is the car that was being used when Kennedy was assassinated in 63. It was a totally open car at that time. After the assassination, it was totally rebuilt from the ground up. There's very little of the original car still there. And at that time, it was armored and it received a fixed top. It was no longer an open car. It became a totally armored, enclosed vehicle.
And it was this concept of rolling armored sanctuary that is credited with helping to save President Ronald Reagan in the 1981 assassination attempt. And so, when the presidential plates were transferred to President George Bush's new $600,000 1989 Lincoln Town Car limousine, it marked another chapter in presidential transportation. 22 feet long and powered by a 7.5-liter engine, President Bush's limousine is reported to be the most comfortable and secure vehicle ever constructed for any resident of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
Be sure to join us next week when we'll look at twin sport coupes from Diamond Star. Lisa Barrow will have an FYI report on auto financing. And Pat Goss will answer two more viewer letters. I'm John Davis. We'll see you then.
If you'd like a transcript of this program, send $4 to Motor Week Transcripts, Owings Mills, Maryland, 21117. Residents of Maryland at 20 cents sales tax. Ask for show number 820.
Join us each Sunday morning at 11 for Motor Week. Now stay tuned to Vermont ETV for a new season of fishing and fun on Rod and Reel, coming up next.
Motor Week is a production of Maryland Public Television.